methylene chloride works on ABS acrylic, works on and it comes in different viscosities. This is, I don't really know, I don't know the brand only in the chain or the store that I shop at. When I was a kid, these always came in glass bottles. And they were a little bit sexier than glass bottles. But now they come in these tin cans. And there's a bigger version, and then you can buy the gallon version. But there's number 3, number 4, and number 16. But those three numbers always seem to apply to all different brands. So the brands, I don't really know much about it, but this is super liquidy. And number 16 is like airplane glue. Remember you use airplane glue? It's kind of more like the consistency of like honey.
What?
Yeah, right. PVC glue has a lot of, has a lot of methylene chloride. It's funny, my students laugh at me, I'm always smelling stuff, and they give me that homework and I immediately smell it, see like what material it is. So I'm always like, oh yeah, that's probably the problem. I'll show you another really good adhesive while we're on adhesives. You guys know, I talked about this in my TIFF video. Anybody ever use dental glue? This is all from my toy businesses. I learned this from my toy business mentors. Jet acrylic comes in this. This is really the same exact stuff that would be used. You ever seen, probably seen one of them that dentures. I know I got a lot of fake teeth. That upper and lower that holds the fake teeth is usually made out of this material in combination with a vacuum form of that same color. So that like kind of gummy, fleshy color. So when you buy jet acrylic, when you buy jet acrylic, I used to buy it from my dentist. He would always laugh at me. He'd be like, hey, can I buy another bottle of that stuff? He'd be like, I don't know what you want it for, but I guess so. But now it's about, I found it online. And jet, this is super fuming. You pour the powder out, and you let this soak in, and it's one of those joints floating around. If you want to fortify a joint, let's say in a prototype, you're making a prototype, you know, a lot of times you make prototypes that have mechanical robotic action, and I know I have in the past, although I'm not good with an Arduino, and you want to make sure your joints don't fall apart. Do a little jet acrylic. It comes in white and it comes in this sort of like gum color. Yeah, just say, when you go to the dentist, hey, can I buy a bottle of jet acrylic for you? And they're like, what? Why do you want that? Don't tell me you're making a bomb. So I'll pass it around, but it's really fumey. You'll start to recognize that smell. It's sort of a dentist office smell. But the cool thing about it is you can pour that powder into a mold to make it really small, strong parts. I used to make molds of gears and make jet acrylic dupes of those gears. So I'd make a silicone mold of a gear. I pour this powder in, a little bit of that acrylic, I don't even know what it's called. They call it jet liquid. But I'm sure, I'm not a scientist, but the chemical makeup of this, I'm sure somebody would recognize instantly. But as this goes through its process, did you guys ever get like a fake cap, temporary cap, while they were making an expensive one?
Yeah.
They usually make it out of this stuff. Because as this goes through its curing process, it kind of becomes a little bit like clay. So in a few minutes, I'm just going to, it's a little premature, I'm just going to roll it into like a little snob. So in a couple minutes, that'll be so hard it'll break. You'll have to snap it like that. So that's jet acrylic. And what I do with my students, if anybody's curious about any of this stuff, I just leave it laying on the table and everyone just comes up and takes pictures of it. Funny the way like teaching has changed. I used to draw on the board and students would sit there for 15 minutes. And now at the end of class, everyone's like this with their high phone taking a picture of the board. And sometimes I teach in a workshop environment too, most of the time. I have a classroom in a workshop environment. In the workshop, I always make sure I have like a big piece of cardboard with me so I can draw on those on the cardboard while I'm talking. And at the end of class, they all just take pictures of the cardboard. So that's jet acrylic, which is really good stuff. And when you buy it, it comes with a couple of like little, it comes with a prep, a chemical, it's like a little prep chemical, but I think that's for like, you know, somebody's mouth. I don't think you need that. just need these two, and it comes with this word. So this is methylene chloride, and 5-minute epoxy. Everyone uses 5-minute epoxy, right? Do you ever use 30-minute epoxy by accident, and you're waiting for the thing to dry, and you actually take the time to read the box? That's really annoying. I've done that before. There's all types of 5-minute epoxies. I tend to use West system only because I like the pump system. There's no real, and I know it's designed for the ocean environment, water environment. It's convenient to have because you'll be in the middle of a project and you're like, I need to glue this together. I want it to be epoxy or whatever it is, and I just go to the thing and I go, and it's ready to go.
West makes a 5-minute.
I don't have it. I use this for the 5-minute stuff, but they do have a quick cure. Like, you have 207 and 105, and it's like 207 base and 105 hardener. They do have a quick hardener. And they have a hardener that stays more clear, it's not going to dry, one that stays yellow, which is quicker. That's a problem with epoxy finishes, because they're kind of yellow. They make some that have like UV protection and stuff, but you got to ask your dealer or whoever you buy them from exactly what. Which epoxies work better.
What do you generally have in your shop? Is that the 207
and 105? Yeah, I use the 207 and the 105 most often. You know, if I'm going to set up, I'll just use it for the week for the night. So, like, if I know it's something I'm going to do, I'll make sure at the end of the day I do it in the morning when I do work on. Because it's a long cure. But a lot of times I get a lot of questions about the tabletop epoxies. That's called, I use the EnviroTech Light, which you can get at Home Depot. And again, that EnviroTech Light kind of tends to be yellow over time. Like, you guys saw my rack stool, which I've done now, it's been over 3 years. And it's yellowing a little bit, but it's still in fairly good shape. I'm surprised it didn't crack or anything. It's actually pretty good shape. But those epoxies have a tendency to kind of stay. They look great at first, but they always kind of tend to like age a little bit. I guess if you keep them out of the sun, that helps. But an interesting thing, I just told somebody the other day, and I'll share with you. Anybody here ever like embed things in epoxy? And did you ever embed things in epoxy and leave and come back and then they're like floating out of the surface of epoxy? And like, you know, like a note, like a really precious note now, like half inch sticking out of the epoxy. You got to make your table like another half inch thicker. Well, a good thing is always mix up a little bit. Put your objects where you want them, let it cure, and then mix up more. So that's why in the rat stool thing, I do it a couple of times. The rat stool thing, I use West epoxy, and then I use that. Yeah, there wasn't really any reason other than just I was experimenting. And like a lot of times I'll do like two or three processes in a video that are kind of that are a little redundant, but it's only just to show some more stuff.
They tend to interact well with epoxy.
Yeah, they seem to be fine. I've never noticed that. But I'm not testing them, like I'm not like dealing with all the bubbles personally. But that's a good question because certain silicone will stick together. Some won't, some epoxy will stay stuck together, some won't. You think of all of a sudden you see like a. That's what happens sometimes too. When you pour layers of epoxy, you're doing the EnviroTech Light and you pour a layer. I encourage you to do it while it's still slightly sticky. So if you realize like the first layer is holding the object safe below the surface of that table you made. If it's starting to get sticky, always leave a little in a cup so you can test it. And then you always want to go, look, it looks like it's hard. You go, okay, just put a hand on it. You get excited. I do it all the time. I walk in the next day, I'm like, oh, is it dry? And I'm like, oh, fuck, I just put a finger right in the middle of my pocket. So you got to remember, leave a little bit in a cup on the side so that you can use that. That's your test.
Dry?
Oh, you know what I do with the heat gun? It's a good question too. I always use the heat gun to pop the bubbles.
Yeah, but in between layers though, you would have to use the heat gun, pop the bubbles.
Yeah. So that's what I'm saying. As it comes to the end of that cure time and it's starting to be a little sticky, pull your next layer. Don't let it cure for like a week and then pull the next layer and let it cure for a week. Because then with dust and oils in the air and stuff, you might end up finding a separation between those layers. Okay. So if you can keep it, I've actually had to pour a bar of ball rail, which is like a long bar, and I built like a little tent in my shop. My shop's full of dust. So I built this tent so that it could like hoping the tent up, go in and do all my work in the tent, and then it had to dry overnight. that would actually work out pretty good. So if you are going to do something that, like, you don't want a lot of dust in, I mean, I'd say my projects, I'm genetically predisposed to dust and dirt, so everything I do is dirty. So I don't even try. When a client comes to me and I want, like, a beautiful, sleek, perfect thing, I'm like, I'm not the right guy to do this shit. I've tried that. This doesn't work for me. It's genetic. You know, some people are born with car problems. Some people are born neat. Some people are born to make, like, perfect dovetail joints. So this is starting to cure. Any questions? Yeah.
Since your shop is in New York, are there any materials that you want to work with that you can't?
Yeah, blacksmithing and smelting. And, you know, that's why I don't do that stuff that much. Guys. Who's the blacksmith?
Brother's the guy.
Tech shop.
I want to watch the guy. He's pouring aluminum and stuff?
He's making nails.
The blacksmith. I want to see those guys. Those are the two guys who started there. I want to see them.
You do that?
I just actually started blacksmithing upstate.
That's
a little
what I was
going
to ask.
But I didn't have a... I don't have a... I was playing the other day, I took a chunk off my milling machine, a chunk of steel, like maybe a half inch by like 2 inches by 2 inches, and I just started beating and whacking it. I have a board from Horseshoe blacksmithing supply place in my house. So it's a gas board, and just put the barbecue burner on it, and it gets like a couple thousand degrees. And I don't have the right tools, and like my anvil's on the ground, so I'm sitting on a milk crate doing this. So I'm like, I wasn't set up to stop filming. I mean, if I do this, I'm going to get trolled. So I want to wait till I'm a little bit more set up professionally looking. Even if it's just ragtag, I just want it to look a little bit more accurate.
That's stuff.
That's stuff. Yeah.
That's all you do.
off the ground. Right. And so I will blacksmith. I started working on this piece. I wish I would have taken a picture of it in the beginning. Just because one of my most important things in videos is that transformative, like, you start here and you end up there. Like, I'm trying to think of something. I'm trying to think of a good Halloween video for me that's coming up next week. I haven't even made it yet. I don't even have a solid idea, but I want to make it funky. But I want to, like, maybe start the video with, like, a piece of MDF, and then at the end have, like, a full form pumpkin. So I want to just try and challenge myself with the techniques of taking that one piece of MDF and figuring out how to turn it into a pumpkin, whether it's a million little pieces glued up or whether it's, like, a cut. Yeah.
That's just your pumpkin.
What do you got?
Earlier you said you had your trickery or white system in.
That's actually funny. Yeah. That's funny. You know what I thought of, which is cool too, but I was going to spend all my time in the video making like this big pitchfork out of like tubes and stuff, and then take a pumpkin and just stamp the pumpkin and pull it out, and the whole face would be infected. And then I'll put it on the video. That would be a good finish for that video.
Yeah.
Like, just take a full pumpkin and just pull it out real fast, and then the eyes and nose and mouth and all of them. So that's a thought. But we'll just say it for them. So any other questions?
Halloween video,
yeah. So the blacksmithing. So I'm at that chunk now, it's like a big piece of gum. It's like a big piece of flat gum with like hammer marks in it. It started out like a perfectly precise cube. So I might do it too. The problem is we go upstate for a couple of days at a time, and I rent my house in between, so we're always up there, like, getting house prepped. And I really need to spend a week up there and do that kind of thing. I got a Beaumont grinder that I bought used up there now, so I'm getting more and more set up for there's like no excuses.
Turn it into a knife, and then you can get all the trolls at once.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's why I have a couple knife concepts. I'm just, like, afraid to come out there. I'm a little intimidated.
Railroad spike.
And I started playing with a railroad spike that same evening, and I just kept hammering until the end of the little bar. And, but that's what I do. Sometimes I'll take material to the extreme just so I know what to expect. Like that night, I've been saying that since I was 4 or 5 days ago. I heated up a small railroad spike that's kind of half size, and I just kept hammering the tip. I was trying to draw it out really long. And I got it really long, and then I was like, well, let me see if I can twist it. I started twisting it, and then it broke apart. So the end just like split up, and then I lost it. But it was cool because I was then able to like heat up the tip of that broken railroad spike and put it on the sharp edge of the anvil and snap it and cut it off. So like things like that that I don't really have experience with doing. That's how I learn. Just stop playing and just screwing things up. Any other questions?
So other than experimenting, do you watch YouTube videos? I mean, that's...
Well, I watch YouTube videos all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Some of my favorite YouTubers are Mr. Pete, T22, Tubal King. People watch him? Yeah, he's great. He's an old shop teacher. I'm trying to think who else. The names don't stick to
Blazing Nail Gun.
Blazing Nail Gun, I love Freddie. Freddie and I just recently became friends at WYA when we were out. You guys all see that, like, funny video David Wilde put up.
I heard about it. You listened to the podcast.
Yeah, it's really funny. David put that together. It's funny. It was a great bonding experience for all of us because we all knew each other from YouTube comments and stuff. And then we all got to hang out together. Then we did that, and we're like, oh, who did what? So it was like, it was really great sense of camaraderie in the whole YouTube world in general. Everybody's really like overwhelmed with like how cool it is. And it's like, I've done the TV business and it's such a sense of competition. There's no, like with the audience, it's like the audience is like someplace else. But with YouTube, it's like everyone's like right there in the same room. Literally, it's like such a great sense of community and everybody's so happy. But you had a question.
Yeah, what's the plan with the Chevy truck upstate?
Oh, right on. We just got the brakes on. I looked at the footage I had and I didn't really have enough to put together for part two. I have to be there to do like one more voiceover to put as like a bed over all the clips I have.
Are you going to build a wood bed for the truck?
I probably will build a metal frame and then put wood rails onto that.
But
that Chevy truck is definitely like my new little obsession. This weekend I put the brakes together. I don't know, I think I talked about it on the podcast. Did I even remember what I was saying? The parts just came in like two Ziploc bags, and I just sat there in front of the wheel hub just trying to figure out how to do it together. With my iPhone, I kept turning off. Like, every time I looked at my iPhone, I would like go to sleep, so then I like go into the app and stay on. And then all of a sudden the sun came out, I couldn't look at my phone in front of the like this is what I'm doing. So, the challenge is fixing up an old piece of junk. Now I gotta do the tubes, the brake lines are all rotted, broken. But it's been a tremendous learning experience, which is the main reason I went to it. It's just, you know, part of my sense of curiosity. And then, you know, I also have this sense of like responsibility to old machines. It's so stupid and it's really not real, but I see an old machine and I'm like, it's like, you know, it's like an orphan pet. All of our pets are from somewhere else. All the pets we have lived another life. And so it's the same thing with machines. You see like a beautiful machine, whether it be a truck, a car, that like, it's got so much character to it and it's just rotting in somebody's backyard. I'm the moron that travels at home.
I come in your shop and what are your ice picks?
The ice picks, I pre-sold 100. So the first 100 in that video are gone. But they're shipping now, so some of them are showing up on YouTube and stuff like that. Some of them are showing up in pictures on Facebook, which is really cool. Because I didn't really expect that until the minute I created it. I have a fulfillment guy, the nails on my phone. So I brought the box to him and he goes, you're going to go out tomorrow. You should be seeing pictures on Instagram in a few days. I was like, well, I didn't even think of that. People are going to come on TV and public are going to come. So everyone loves it, of course. It's been very positive. You know, I'm waiting for the first thing to fall out and then to get up the bed.
Yep.
But I'm going to make another 100 soon. But I'm also in the process of manufacturing. So I don't know what happened, but when you manufacture from Hong Kong, you typically have an agent. And that agent handles everything for you. You need to go between you and the factory. So yeah, I don't really deal with the factory directly. So my agent is an old friend of mine from the toy business, my friend Charles. And Charles just emailed me last night saying the factory, something went completely wrong. And so we have to start with a new factory. I don't know what. But I sent him the video and I said, now you have something to build on. Because we were kind of working in the dark. I sent him a sample. This isn't that hard to make. It really isn't. But the factory sent a sample that looked pretty good, but they screwed up this joint right here, which I ended up making real simple. We had another complicated way to do it. But anyway, so the factory is going to be hopefully catching up soon. So I'm going to keep making 100 at a time until the factory production comes in.
All right,
you got to go on the website, my website. But I will probably, if you want, give me your email, and I'll tell you the day before I put them up. It's going to be a few days. I got to talk to my wife about it. Do you have a question? Just a little bit more about glues and adhesives. This is, you guys, the woodworkers in the room, go to Woodcraft. Is there a Woodcraft in Pittsburgh?
Rockwood.
Oh, Rockwood. Rockwood sells these adhesives, these CA glue?
CA glue. Yeah. I get mine on Amazon.
Oh, yeah. So I first saw these available at it's funny, different industries. Taylor makes shoes, so occasionally we go into these, like, really well-stocked shoe supply places. And I recommend anybody in this room who's curious about making stuff. Whenever I go to a new city, especially in Europe, which I haven't been to in a while, but anytime I go to a new city, I always immediately go to the hardware store to see what kind of weird, cool stuff they have. Especially if it's an old hardware store that's been there for generations. They got the greatest like spring section, the greatest screw section. You know, now you gotta like buy a little true value pocket plastic, big two screws. But you go to like these old hardware stores and they have like these drawers full of cool stuff. And if it's a good place, it's all really well organized. So I first started buying CA glue by the bottle like this at a shoe supply place that we were going to Brooklyn. And they would have a big bottle like this. And then one day I was in Woodcraft in Chicago and I saw they had these whole range of different thicknesses, different type of activators. And I was like, oh my God, my whole world is like opening up. Because for years I was buying little bottles of crazy glue from the corner store. I'd go to the deli and I'd buy coffee and a bottle of crazy glue. And I would hot glue the crazy glue bottles under my bench, so I'd always know where they were because I could never find them, so they were always hot glued under my bench. And for years I was using the hot glue trick with baking soda. Does anybody know that? When you take hot glue and you sprinkle baking soda, literally like the Arm & Hammer baking soda box, you sprinkle that on the little, just like I did with this. You put a little pile of baking soda and you squirt it with hot glue, there's some sort of chemical reaction that
you mean crazy glue?
What?
Hot glue or crazy glue?
Crazy glue. Am I saying hot glue?
Yeah. Sorry.
Crazy glue, or CA glue, and baking soda. Mm. It'll make a little super hard compound that, yeah. It'll also create a burning fume. So don't do it anywhere near your face. It'll make a fume and you'll pass out. You know that fume that comes up with crazy glue sometimes? You know, that's the other thing too. A lot of my students find out the hard way. They'll take like a beautiful pair of glasses and fix something with crazy glue and then you get that fume on the acrylic. Crazy glue fumes, so you gotta, it makes this vapor which will make a stain on acrylic. So don't use crazy glue next to anything that's important, that's acrylic. You'll get that vapor which doesn't go away. And it also, that vapor will stick to fingerprints, which is what they use in CSI. They'll take a little tray of CA glue and heat it in an oven next to a letter that's got some evidence on it, and the CA glue vapor will stick to the skin and fingerprints. And you're gonna, one of these days, everybody here is gonna make something and not think about it and crazy glue it. And you're gonna come back later, there's gonna be like fingerprint vapors all around the area of work. It's crazy glue vapor. And it happens very accelerated and very much when you put that stuff in the baking soda. So if you're holding something in your hand, it'll get really hot. That's all I'm saying. Hot and vapor, you don't wanna be your eyes. But this is an accelerator. So when you use the crazy glue, or CA glue, you glue your joint and then you spray it. Sorry.
No, you're cool.
I'm making sure. This smells like roses. It's manufactured. I'm going to recommend that when you see this display in Woodcraft specifically, don't buy this version. There's three versions. I bought two cans of this, so I'm using it up. But this can doesn't seem to work as well as a different brand. They have it there in the aerosol cans, and then they have it in the little pump bottle. I haven't had a coffee since I woke up. I haven't had a coffee drink for like a parched brand. I walked in and they were struggling. So the little pump bottle activator seems to work better. I think sometimes it's called Zap It.
Zip Quick, Zap Gap.
That's right. Zip Quick or Zap Gap. That works, tends to work better than this stuff. And then every time I spray this, I just feel like I'm killing myself. Among a million of us, I'm pumping it. I know. I'm going to use it. That's horrible. Any other questions?
Some of the CA, I've seen it since wood. Is there really...
There's no difference.
That's right.
Yeah. I tell a lot of... One of the great things that I use most often for a lot of the things is a glue called goop. That is just goop at all, it's like a silicone, it's like a high-tech silicone. Lexel, which I've used in the Brompton sign video, is the same type of stuff, it's like an industrial version of it. But goop, when you look in the store, it says shoe goop, car goop, boat goop, it's all the same goop. But it's really smart of them to do that because, you know, people go to the hardware store and they're like, my shoes grow goop. Oh, well, shoe goop. But it's the same stuff in different packages. So when they say, like, right, this is sold by Typon. The Typon just got on board and said, hey, you know, everyone's using this. I think what happened was a lot of woodworkers were using it to make mistakes. You know, it probably works better. that's a neat where that's a product that came from the user, as opposed to the company product. But they saw the opportunity to patent. So now CA glue is CA means cyanoacrylate.
So a lot of people say CA glue. Oh, any other questions, thoughts, comments?
Anyone want to share? Yes, sir.
I'm going to share.
Yeah.
Remember when you made the bubble detector case?
Yes.
I actually made one.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. The only two I have is jigsaw
on the side. Oh, wow. Yeah. Yeah. That's the one thing I always try to do a little bit of a twist in all my videos. So instead of just making like a box, I create a leather line on it.
Yeah.
And I put the leather in before I assembled it. So that was, I was trying to show a couple of things. It's so funny now how phones have gotten, I got the 6 Plus. When somebody gives me, like, it's like this. When somebody hands me like the regular old iPhone, it's like I'm like this. Are they getting smaller as other phones are getting bigger? It's just incredible how tiny it is. And I made that box for like the, whatever, the 4S.
Yeah.
And so when I pick the box up, it's like, oh, you have the edge. How do you have the edge?
Love it. Absolutely love it. Best one I've ever had.
No, I was thinking about getting one or another member just for fun. Is that an old edge or just one side?
This is note 4 with the edge.
Oh, cool. Any other thoughts, comments? Yes, sir?
Please start the model of presentation.
I'm sorry?
Please start the model of presentation.
I think you said